Ironically, it is almost 45 years to the day since the world was plunged into the last global crisis.
While the blockade of Taiwan is a particularly provocative piece of brinksmanship on the part of the Chinese, defense analysts think it highly unlikely that national pride will make them want to take the world to the brink.
Would your country really put the world at risk by breaking this blockade?
Ma'am, there are two realities here. The State Department would like to continue to ease the Chinese and the world community. Politicians, however, face re-elections.
Prepare the surface.
Prepare the surface.
Depth 5-8 feet.
First time in human history, we now were capable of our own destruction as a species.
The bomb affects everything.
It was the opening shot of the Cold War.
The bomb has receded in the public's imagination, but it's still there.
We still live in its shadow.
Everybody's affected by it. There's no place to hide.
It is an environmental issue. It's a political issue. It's a moral issue. It is the most important issue that we face.
1,400 Cuban exiles, secretly trained and equipped by the CIA, landed at the Bay of Pigs on Cuba's southern coast. The CIA expected the invasion to trigger a popular uprising inside Cuba, but they underestimated Castro's strength. There was no uprising, and the invasion was a miserable failure.
There's an old saying that victory has 100 fathers and defeat is an orphan. And,
I think it was the first thing he ever really lost.
But the Bay of Pigs invasion and subsequent attempts to assassinate Castro convinced the Soviets and the Cubans that the U.S. was bent on destroying the revolution. Cuba had become an icon of the superpower conflict. 2 months later, still smarting from his fiasco at the Bay of Pigs, Kennedy flew to Vienna for what turned out to be a tense and hostile summit meeting with Nikita Khrushchev.
Mr. Khrushchev said, if there's any attempt on the part of the West to interfere with these arrangements, there will be war. Well, now, diplomacy, you don't use that word war very often. You talk about the gravest possible consequences or something of that sort. But Kennedy had to look Khrushchev straight in the eye and say, then, Mr. Chairman, there will be war.
Nuclear weapons had become the central tool of superpower diplomacy. During that tense September of 1961, the Soviets tested the largest hydrogen bomb the world had ever seen. But they had only about 6 intercontinental missiles capable of striking the American mainland.
In the 1970s, the United States and the Soviet Union began to realize the dangers of nuclear weapons and the threats that accompanied them. In an effort to make the world safer and ease tensions, the two nations attempted to take steps to limit the numbers of these weapons. These discussions came to be known as the Strategic Arms Limitation Talks, more commonly known as SALT. After years of failed negotiations, the first real progress came in 1971, when the two nations reached an agreement to limit the number of anti-ballistic missile systems. Several years later, a second round of negotiations occurred. These discussions became known as the Strategic Arms Limitation Talks II, or SALT II. These discussions took place from 1977 to 1979, between U.S. President Jimmy Carter and Soviet Premier Brezhnev. The results of SALT II were a series of promises by both sides to limit the production of nuclear weapons.